A month has passed, and many things have changed in the world of Aldrant. The land's a couple thousand feet lower than it once was, the church has had some of its dark underbelly exposed to the public, and the miasma is starting to feel like just a bad memory. However, despite an ever-changing world, some things remain constant. For example, Luke. Despite defeating Van, saving the world, and gaining the respect of his peers, he just can't seem to shake that small little niggling feeling inside that he's still a massive pussy. You see, despite all the great stuff Luke did, this past month he's done exactly nothing. Well, technically not nothing. He spent most of his time locked away in his room, building a nice little collection of doubts and worries. Now that he doesn't really have anything to work towards, he's had a lot of time to think about who he is, or more precisely, what he is. For some reason, he's got it in his head that one day Ash is going to return to the Fabra Manor, and he's going to be kicked to the curb like the filthy replica that he is, because obviously there's not enough love in Luke's parents' hearts for two children. Anyways, after a month of moping and worrying, his parents get fed up and tell him to go sort out his feelings somewhere else. So Luke decides that, well, he's sick of waiting for Ash. I mean, if he's going to eventually appear and kick Luke out of his home, he wants it to be done sooner rather than later. So he sets off to find where Ash is, and what he's been up to for the past month. After a quick stop in Sheridan to pick up the Albiar, Luke heads to Yulia City, the last place where Ash was apparently seen. Oh, and I guess Tyr will be there as well, huh? Yeah, I guess that's another reason to go. Anyways, upon arrival, you meet with Teradoro, and you find out that Ash left a while ago, muttering something about Lorelei. Luke wonders if it's related to that voice he heard when he defeated Van.
Ash, Luke, I will send you the key. Use it to set me free. One who would seize glory is trying to capture me.
But whatever, after that, Luke decides to drop by Tyr's place. Turns out, she's actually been in a pretty similar state to Luke. At least in the sense that she hasn't done much for the past month. She did, after all, take part in the death of her own brother. No matter how justified it was, it still hurts. Her and Luke have a bit of a heart-to-heart, and Luke talks a bit about his insecurities. About him being a replica, and him being afraid that he'll be discarded once he has no use. Tyr reminds him that he gave a rather impassioned speech about Natalie being the daughter to the king, despite not being related by blood, and how similar her situation was to his current one, but Luke brushes the completely rational argument aside.
You pussy.
In any case, Tyr suggests that Luke go talk with his old companions and see what they have to say on the matter on who Luke really is. She also agrees to go along with Luke so that she can help, so that she can deliver a report to Phone Master Ion. Yep, just that. Luke is worried about her coming along, you know, that whole miasma poisoning her phonons thing that went on. But she pushes his worries aside. I mean, while she may be weakened, she has medicine that counters the miasma's effects, and with the actual miasma gone from the land, her condition isn't going to get any worse than it is. So the two of you head to Doth to catch up with Ion and Annis, as well as turn in Tyr's report. It seems like she's been monitoring the state of the core of the planet, and it looks like it's been vibrating a little more violently lately. It's nothing too troubling at the moment, but if the trend continues, in the long term, it could mean the failure of the Tartarus and the return of the miasma. Anyways, once you arrive in Doth, you meet up with Annis, who's apparently had a bit of a hectic month. Basically, she's been run ragged doing odds and ends for the church now that Ion has resumed control over it. And well, it seems that the general public, upon receiving the news that, hey, their religion that they followed their entire lives might be a total lie, haven't been taking it too well. But other than that, Annis seems completely,
Okay, wait for me at the cathedral. Ugh, you people sure are demanding. You don't have any idea the situation I'm in.
Normal? After catching up with her for a bit, the three of you head to meet with Ion. First off, Luke asks the two of them what they think about his situation. Annis scoffs at the pointlessness of his worry, while Ion gives some vague but positive advice. So basically, exactly what you'd expect out of the two. After that, Tyr turns in a report on the core. It seems like the planet's storm's power is increasing, and that's why it's causing the vibrations to increase. Scarily enough, though, this was the exact plan that Van was going for when he tried to destroy the land. While Van is definitely dead, it looks like someone else may be trying to carry out his plan. In any event, thoughts on what could be the cause of all this are interrupted by a familiar face, Guy. His noble lineage now revealed, he's been living the easy life in Malkuth as a noble in the king's court. Unfortunately for him, it's also been a pretty boring life so far. Anyways, he's here on behalf of Malkuth in order to report to Ion, so he's just as surprised as you are when he runs into you. The news he came to deliver is a little worrisome. Apparently Dis, the last remaining of the god generals, broke free from his prison in Malkuth. To make matters worse, immediately upon his escape, he tracked down and abducted Grand Maestro Mos, who had been in holding awaiting his trial for his crimes. It's unsettling news, though it's tough to imagine what the group of you can do right now about it. Guy also offhandedly mentions that he ran into Ash a little while back, and that he'd been looking into Lorelei and the god generals. So he's been worried about the god generals, huh? He almost certainly heard that same voice that Luke did. I know, let's ask our friends about what that voice was talking about. Never mind, let's just go chase after Ash instead without any explanation. So after Annis very naturally asked to come with you, your group head to the passage ring near Stampina to try and track down Ash. There you find him locked in combat with LaGretta. Your group quickly jump in to assist Ash, and LaGretta is forced to retreat, but before leaving mentions something called the Key of Lorelei. It looks like someone really is trying to reawaken Van's plan to create a replica world. LaGretta. And not only that, I mean, if she survived an entire mountainside coming down on her, then there's a very good chance that Largo and Arietta did as well. And with Dist on the loose as well, it could very well be that the four god generals are working in tandem to make Van's dream a reality. But I mean, at the very least, Sink's dead. Nothing could survive falling into the literal center of the planet. Well, Ash claims that it's possible that all of the god generals are alive. He isn't certain on the matter, but there does seem to be signs that Sink may be alive. And well, if Sink was able to survive, then... oh dear. Anyways, your group ask Ash what the hell is going on, and he explains a bit. Basically, Lorelei was trapped, and he's been searching for a way to free it. The reason Ash needs to do this is because without Lorelei, 7th phonons will stop being produced, which in turn will cause the planet storm to start artificially creating them, which again in turn will cause the core to vibrate. However, when you ask about where the heck Lorelei is trapped, he simply states that Luke already knows before leaving once again. Alright, Luke, buddy, maybe now's the time to ask your friends about what Lorelei said to you. Maybe they can think of something you couldn't. You know, you only have 7 years worth of memories. Maybe there's something really obvious that just you didn't understand. So if we just ask them to... and of course we're not gonna tell them, are you? Anyways. As you make your way to leave, who should you run into but Jade? Jade had probably the most straightforward month of the lot of you. He just returned to his job in the military. He was apparently on a bit of a routine survey of the area when his soldiers were attacked by men in Kenlossian uniforms. Since you guys have the Albior, you offer to take them back to the capital so they can receive the aid a lot faster, which Jade happily agrees to. There, you meet with the king to discuss what happened. Were there really Kinlaskan troops attacking the Malkuth military? Well, according to the troops themselves, it doesn't actually seem that way. While there were Kinlaskan military uniforms on some of the soldiers, a lot of them were just wearing regular clothes. And the attacks hardly seemed organized. They were sort of scrappy, desperate guerrilla tactics. They really don't seem like something a kingdom military would resort to. Anyways, the king and Jade asked Luke to talk with the king of Kimlaska about what just transpired and make sure it really wasn't him behind the attack, as well as inform him that there may be forces impersonating the Kimlaskan army. Luke takes this moment to remind everyone that he's still a pussy.
Luke, did I get you to do that?
I wonder if they'll listen to me.
What are you talking about? You're King Engelbert's nephew.
Whatever. Anyways, it seems that the king is also aware of the situation regarding Ash, and that he may in fact have this Key of Lorelei. While he's not exactly sure what this key is, there are legends about it, and that it could possibly be used to calm the planet storm, stop it from forcing these vibrations within the Earth. The key and Ash, it all ties back to Lorelei, and Tyr asks Luke what exactly it was that Lorelei actually said to him. So Luke tells her, finally. And of course, as he says what happened, everyone immediately bolts upright. It turns out, one who would seize power actually translates to Vandis Delca in ancient Hispanian. Ancient Hispanian, of course, being an offshoot of the much more popular ancient language plot convenientese. So it looks like what Lorelei meant was he was about to be captured by Van, and he was going to send Luke and Ash a key in order to free him. Only it seems like Ash got the key, but Luke never got any sort of key or anything like, did he? Okay, there's a lot of moving pieces here, a lot of mysteries to unpack. There's Ash and the Key, the whereabouts of Logretta and the other God Generals, the escape of Dist and Mose, and finally the attack of the Malkuth military. For now, confirming the status of the mystery forces that attacked Malkuth seems like the easiest option to deal with, so your group head to Kinlaska to talk with the King. Once there, you run into Natalia. She spent the past month a lot busier than Luke did, attending to all sorts of formal affairs regarding the kingdom. After giving Jade a stern talking to about how Kinlaska would never dare sully its good name, she brings you to meet with the King. The group of you ponder on why would a force impersonate the Kinlaskan military. One likely option springs to mind, to incite conflict between Kinlaska and Malkuth. Of course, your group consider that this may very well be Mose up to his old tricks, trying to make the world follow the score to a T. So your group, Natalia included, decide to head to Doth to talk about what exactly the world should do about the score. I mean, it's off track at this point, but it's also kind of the world religion. It's gonna be tough to figure out where to go from here without inciting a massive rebellion. In any case, it's off to Doth, though Annis seems less than enthused to go back.
I told them that in my letter, so let's pass, okay?
What, you don't want to go home?
No, it's not that.
Okay, then we're off to Doth.
Luke, take care of Natalia.
Yes, Your Majesty.
So you head back to Doth, where Tyr immediately collapses. Uh-oh.
Would you say it's time for everyone to panic?
Yes, I would, Kent.
You bring her to Ion's room so she gets a chance to rest. It's tough to say what's going on. I mean, her condition was bad, but it shouldn't be getting any worse. The miasma is gone.
Ion, we have a problem. Annis, just where have you been? That's what I'm saying. We have a serious problem outside.
What's happened?
The miasma's everywhere. It's seriously bad. Ion, please, come quickly.
Professor, without knowing precisely what the danger is, would you say it's time for our viewers to crack each other's heads open and feast on the goo inside?
Yes, I would, Kent.
Well, shit. Anyways, Annis drags Ion off to go and try and survey the situation. The rest of your group are still worried about Tyr, but she forces herself back to her feet. If the miasma's back, nowhere is safe for her, so for now you just need to see what you can do to put a stop to it. So you rush out to find Ion, where... oh. You find a small contingent of Oracle soldiers, led by Logretta. They have you surrounded, but you're almost immediately saved by, Arietta. She claims that Logretta is working with Mose in order to make Ion read the seventh phone stone, the final piece of the score that has now been discovered. But if Ion reads the entire phone stone, he's already weak and sickly. The power he would need to expend would be... With Arietta covering your flank, your group rush forward to catch up with Ion. Eventually, you manage to find him, being escorted by Mose and Annis. It looks like she's been working for Mose. And not just recently, either. She's been working for him the entire journey. All those times, every time the God Generals appeared, whenever it just seemed like they seemed to have perfect information on where we were, how we were acting. It was all because of Annis. However, it seems like she's not exactly loyal to Mose. More like he has something on her, or to be more specific, something on her parents. While she does run off telling your group not to follow her, she also tosses Guy a message telling you of an alternate route that you can track down Mose with. There's no real time to think on why Annis would do all this. For now, you just need to try to save Ion before something terrible happens. You head off down the alternate route that Annis gave to you, only to be stopped by... replicas? Familiar faces of people already dead block your exit out of Doth. It looks like Mose and the God Generals have been working together to create an army of them. In fact, these replicas were probably the ones who attacked the Malkuth military. You don't have time to deal with them right now, though. Tyr puts them to sleep, and your group hurriedly make your way towards Ion. And after dodging some lava and defeating a literal dragon, you find him, but you're too late. He's already reading the Phone Stone, discovering the true end to the score. But the score, it doesn't show prosperity. The end that the score foretells is destruction. Luke rushes forward and tries to pry Ion away from the phone stone. Just before he can, Ion reads one particular passage from the score. One about Luke. Claims that he will head to the researcher city. There he will find a cure for the miasma through the use of a forbidden power. His reading complete, Ion slumps to the floor in Luke's arms. He's exceedingly weak, but he has enough strength in him for one final act. He reaches his hand out to Tyr, and takes the miasma within her into his own body. With that done, he says his goodbye to Luke, Tyr, and Ennis, before fading away. Of course, Moe's can't help but take this moment to gloat. Your group is livid at his comments and turn to face him, but he simply flees, leaving a wall of replicas to guard his escape. For now, you take Ennis back to Doth, where you run into Marietta. She'd only helped you and betrayed the God Generals in order for you to help Ion, and well, we didn't exactly do that, did we? She blames Ennis for his death, and Ennis can't exactly deny it either. Marietta challenges her to a duel, one to make her pay for the terrible deeds she committed. Ennis accepts that, in the not-too-distant future, the two of them will settle things. With that fun event hanging in the future, Marietta leaves. Ennis has kept a pretty brave face after everything that happened, but it looks like now that everything has calmed down, it's all starting to sink in. She runs off, and Luke manages to track her down. She was responsible for Ion's death, but in the end, she had done it to save her parents. She'd been put in a hell of a situation. One where there were no right answers, only painful ones. Luke comforts her.
Ennis, here, take this. I picked it up in Mount Zalejo. It's a fragment of the Phone Stone from the score Ion read.
Ion's Phone Stone!
You know, despite being so overly self-deprecating, the guy really does know how to find the silver lining in other people's clouds. Anyways, Ion made sure to tell you one thing before he died, a potential lead on how to remove the miasma. So your group head to Belkin to talk with the scientist there about how it could possibly be stopped. So you talk with one of the researchers there about any potential way to remove the miasma, and they mention the power of hyperresonance. I mean, hyperresonance has the power to literally destroy matter down to its core. So, technically speaking, it could destroy the miasma, but it would take a lot of 7th phonons, roughly the amount inside 10,000 7th phonists. Not only that, the removal of the 7th phonons from those people would almost certainly kill them, as well as the person doing the hyperresonance. So your group need to think of another way that you can possibly try to get rid of the miasma. Okay, so, you remember in the last video how I said that this game loves to get sidetracked? Well, that's about to happen a whole lot now, so buckle in, kids. So, we're looking for a way to neutralize the miasma, but as you're making the leave, you hear about this scorer that's been visiting the town. Apparently, they've been reading people's scores without the church's consent. Basically, they're feeding the people's needs to stay true to their old ideals, aka following the score, even though they are ultimately false readings. So you talk with the researchers about the scorer, and you find that Ash was in the area as well. So you follow him to Mountain O'Neill, where you happen upon a locket that just so happens to contain a picture of a very young Natalia. So Luke hides it from the rest of your group while you enter the passage to meet with Ash. There, Ash finally explains fully what's going on. Basically, Lorelei was trapped inside the core, and when Van Pelt and he somehow managed to absorb Lorelei within him. And well, since Lorelei is the sentient of the 7th phonon, the phonon that includes healing, it may very well have kept Van alive. Anyways, to free him, you need the Key of Lorelei, and the Key of Lorelei is made up of two parts, the Jewel of Lorelei and the Sword of Lorelei. Ash received the sword back when he heard the voice, and Luke was supposed to have received the jewel, but for some reason, he didn't. As such, the key is incomplete, and Lorelei can't be freed. So for the time being, Ash is heading to every Sephiroth to see if the jewel is present in any of them. While he does that, your group decide to go back and check Combaticle about where that scorer who's spreading fake readings was supposedly headed. You search around to find him, but only end up running into Moe's and Dist. You give chase, but Dist uses some kind of art on Moe's, transforming him into... whatever that is, and the two fly off. Well, that was weird. But you also take the time to talk with the king about the locket you found, without Natalia's knowledge, and realize it was probably belonging to Largo, and that Largo is probably her true father. Anyways, you head to Quesadonia to talk with Natalia's old nanny, only to accidentally happen upon the fake scorer, who turns out to be Sync. It turns out he and the rest of the God Generals are working with Moe's to create a new Order of Lorelei, one that will return the world to the score. At least, that's Moe's wish. The God Generals probably have other plans. You can't do much about Sync, though, and the people seem pretty desperate to have their score read, so you leave him for a time and confirm with the nanny that yes, Largo really is Natalia's father. So you head to Yulia City to talk about what to do with the current Order of Lorelei, since, you know, Ion's dead and a bunch of people seem to be defecting to the new Order. Anyway, so after talking with Teodora about what to do with the church, he tells you about some weird rumor about a moving island. So you set out to search for it and eventually come across what truly is a moving island. So you land there and find out that it's actually an island that was destroyed in the Hod War, though how it's back and moving is anyone's guess. So you check around, find out that it was the base of operations for the God Generals, and that this is where they've been pumping out those replicas. You talk with the replicas a bit, and as you do, Moses' true plan is revealed. Yes, somehow Moses awakened ancient technology, and the city of Hod can now fly. Unfortunately, it seems to be protected by the planet storm and actual cannons, so you can't just fly in. So you head to Grand Kokma to figure out what to do about the flying city, only to hear an announcement from Moes echo out over all of Aldrand. A rally for the people to rise up and return to the score, since the original Order of Lorelei has forsaken it. Anyways, you talk with the king and set up a meeting for Gamlaska, Malkuth, and Doth to all come together and work to stop Moes and the new order. You set out to collect the leaders, only to be reminded that Arietta wanted that duel with Annis, and she wants to do that now. So you go and fight Arietta and ultimately kill her, yes, this time she's actually dead, and head off to pick up the world leaders so they can meet in Doth and make plans to deal with the score and Moes. So you head to Batacle, only to find out that it's blocked by a massive group of replicas, but they aren't attacking anyone anymore, they just sort of seem to be aimlessly drifting. And you find out that Moes has basically decided that a lot of them have filled their purpose and, well, just sort of left them to run amok on the land. They don't have orders to do anything, so they're not really attacking anyone, they're just kind of hanging around. Anyways, you help to settle a bunch of citizens. Luke points out the most obvious flaw in the entire score, the fact that it only comes true if you follow it, so it's not really a prediction after all. And you go to pick up the king, only to bump into Ash. There, they start to think of a way to neutralize the miasma.
Alright, whose fault is it that it went that badly?
I wonder.
Why don't you try thinking about that? Hard.
Sorry.
So anyways, remember that thing about the hyperresonance needing a literal shit ton of 7th phonons in order to destroy the miasma? Well, it just so happens that these replicas are loaded with 7th phonons. But it would still require them to, die. Ash, upon learning about how the hyperresonance works, calls it stupid, before leaving for unspecified reasons. Your group shrug and begin to leave the city as well, only to find out that he actually was going to do it, and that he was just too sundere to tell you he was. So you head to a large tower where a number of replicas have been gathering to try and stop Ash before he pulls out the plan. After a meaningless battle with Dist, you confront Ash and the army of replicas. It looks like the replicas have agreed to be part of the hyperresonance. Most of them are barely sentient, and the ones who can speak find no reason to continue on in a world that shuns their very existence. In essence, they agree to do it because they have nothing else to live for. But of course, there's still the question of who's going to perform the hyperresonance, as they're going to die as well. And the only two capable of performing it on command are Luke and Ash. Which means... Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the first ever annual Aldrant Emo-Off! Welcome everyone, thank you for coming! Alright, let's meet our two lovely contestants. First up, we have Luke von Fabra. Now tell us, Luke, why do you think you should be the one to die for all of humanity?
No, I'm the same as you. I don't want to die. But I'm a replica. I'm weaker. I couldn't even receive the jewel to free Lorelei. It needs you, not me. The one who dies here should be the one who's unneeded. The replica. Me!
Alright, alright. Strong argument. I can really feel the emo behind this one. Now we have to move on to our second contestant, Ash the Bloody. So, Ash, baby doll, why don't you lean over and give us a little hint about why you should be the one to take the ultimate sacrifice?
Disappear in my place, you piece of... Stop! We're trying to destroy the miasma here, not Doth! Listen to me. You ate my whole existence. That's why I'm going to do this!
Ash, is there really no other way?
They both make pretty strong arguments, folks. It'll be tough to decide which one is more of a pussy. Let's just sit back and see how it plays out, shall we?
No! I can't let you die!
What the? The sword's reacting. Is the jewel nearby?
Let go!
I agree with Luke. If we must choose one, it should be the original.
Luke, stop!
Everyone, give me your lives! I'm going with you!
I don't want to die! I don't want to die! I don't want to die! I want to stay here! Not for anybody else! I want to live! But... it's not working!
The seventh phonons that had gathered are dissipating. The miasma won't be neutralized.
The jewel! The jewel's power to disperse is interfering! Damn it! That idiot just didn't realize he had it! Could he possibly be any more of a nuisance?
Don't worry. I have no intention of dying with you. I'm just going to give your hyper-resonance some power. You can disappear by yourself.
Thanks, Ash.
Oh, they're both sacrificing themselves. Who could have seen that one coming? Well, that's it for Aldrin's first ever emo off. I hope you'll stop by next time when we find out who can kill themselves first. Well, not too surprisingly, Luke and Ash somehow both managed to survive the ordeal. To make matters even better, it turns out Luke really did have the Jewel of Lorelei all along. It was just sort of dissolved in his body. But even more importantly than that, this near-death experience, it changed Luke. He realized something. While the fear of death surrounded him at every corner, he realized that he didn't want to die. That despite claiming he was inferior, that he deserved to die, not Ash, he didn't want to. He wasn't a replacement for Ash. He never had been. He was his own person. Luke had finally learned how to live for himself. He'd finally learned how to be a dick. Well, anyways, that literally should have killed Luke and Ash, and yet the two seemed to be fine. Jade suggests that Luke actually get a proper examination with a doctor to make sure everything really is okay. But I mean, we're nearing the end of the game. What could possibly go?
I'll be blunt. You should check into this hospital immediately.
Why?
The phonons binding your cells together are separating and declining dramatically. It's highly likely that very soon, your cells will disintegrate, and you will die.
Oh. Yes, it seems that while death wasn't instantaneous, Luke really is fated to... die, though it's tough to say exactly how long he has. Luke tries to hide the fact from the rest of the group, but Jade, being the man that he is, figures out he's lying pretty easily. And surprisingly, Tyr does as well.
Oh, it's you. What's with the serious look?
Is it true your phonons are separating?
Who told you that?
Mew. He told me what you and the Colonel had discussed.
That little... damn it!
How is your condition? Will you get better?
The doctor said it was too late.
No.
Anyways, death or none, you still need to put a stop to Modes and the God Generals, and then. Fortunately, with the jewel, you now actually have the key of Lorelei, so the ability to free him is possible. First off, though, you have to be able to enter that flying city of Hod, and to do that, you have to get past the mystical energy that is drawing from the Planet Storm, so you need to shut down the Planet Storm. This would, over time, lead to a decrease in phonons and eventually the loss of all magic, but it's kind of unavoidable at this point. That's just a problem the scientists of the future will have to deal with. For now, you have to put a stop to it. To do that, you have to head to the two largest Sephiroths, the Absorption Gate and the Radiation Gate, and shut them both down. So you head to the Absorption Gate first. There, you find the remaining God Generals, and, well, obviously they're fighting Ash. Oh, and Mose is there, and... oh boy. Man makes to leave, and your group try to put a stop to him, but you're cut off by Largo. Your group are forced to deal with him while Ash gets chased after Van. He puts up a really tough fight, putting his all into this,
his final battle. But ultimately, he's not strong enough to beat all of you, and he falls. In any event, you have to shut down the planet storm, and you use the jewel to begin the process when...
And I know why.
Why, man?
Yeah, hey, cause I got high. Because I got high. Because I got high. La da 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 da.
Well, that was weird. Your task complete, you now head for the radiation gate to fully bring the planet storm to an end. There you run into Mose again, but this time he's alone. Whatever the heck this did to him, it seems to be affecting his mind. His thoughts have become corrupted, unsettling. He randomly bursts out into laughter or suffers minor fits of insanity. At this point, killing him might honestly be more of a mercy. You take him on, despite possessing some power, he eventually does fall to your party, before turning into a hideous Moe's pancake. Despite everything he did, despite being a bona fide asshole, to the end of it all, he really was just following what he believed to be true, following a path that he believed would bring prosperity to the world. In any case, with him out of the way, you're able to officially shut down the planet storm. With the planet storm down, the defenses surrounding the city should be a lot weaker, and you should be able to go and confront Van directly. You meet up with Ash, you can finally combine the jewel and the sword and create the Key of Lorelei. Luke hands over the jewel so that Ash can put it together and free Lorelei. Ash finally speaks his true thoughts to Luke. Why he really hates Luke. Because Luke constantly puts himself down. He constantly says he's inferior, he's just a copy, a replacement, that he's not good enough to fulfill the role. How could someone with such feeble fucking emotions, with such a quivering, pussy-like attitude, have replaced his life? But Luke, that's the record straight. He's not giving the jewel to Ash because Ash is the original or because he feels he's inferior to him. He's giving it to him because Luke thinks Ash is the better one for the job. Because Luke and Ash aren't the same person. Luke is himself. This sudden change in behavior in Luke, the ability to be a dick and live for himself, it infuriates Ash. Despite all that's gone on, despite losing everything, despite watching that useless replica take everything that should have been his, at the end of it all, Ash is the one who's still an asshole. He storms off, heading for Hod. The rest of your group get ready to head into Hod to prepare for the final battle that awaits you. You spend a night in Kessidonian to gather supplies and mentally prepare for what's to come. Natalia and Guy share a few words on their childhood companions. Annis and Jade share some of their thoughts on the future. And Tyr and Luke.
Tomorrow.
Yeah. I hope my body holds together until then.
It will.
Tyr.
Tomorrow, and the day after, and on and on.
Tyr.
What is it?
Never mind.
You're weird.
I am not. I just... Thanks.
What's with you all of a sudden?
You watched me this whole time, just like you promised.
You idiot. I'm going to keep on watching you, too.
You're the idiot. I'm going to disappear.
It's okay.
It's weird. I'm really happy right now. I have friends, and you? I can finally think of myself as me. This is probably the happiest moment of my life.
What?
I mean, I wish I could think it wouldn't be.
All that's left is to head into Hod. After Van literally tries to crash the city into you, you head inside, where you find LaGretta. She claims that everything up till now has been done in the name of Van. that her only wish is to see his wish fulfilled. However, Tyr brushes her thoughts aside. The fact that all of this has been done just for Van, for some guy without considering her own feelings? It's hardly the attitude of a powerful knight, hardly the attitude of the one Tyr once called her teacher. So your group clash with her, and just like Largo, LaGreta pulls out all the stops. But it's too late for your group to be stopped here, and you bring this once mighty enemy to an end. With that finished, you now have the slightly intimidating task of navigating the massive fortress that makes up this place. It's crawling with soldiers and monsters, and there's probably even some traps.
That's all, folks.
Well, looks like the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, or in this case, the replica doesn't fall far from the original. Looks like Ash fell for the same trap Luke did. Unfortunately, it looks like a Zelda puzzle is blocking their exit, and someone needs to activate the pad to open the only door out of the room. Once again, Luke offers the jewel to Ash, claiming that since Ash is more skilled in hyper-resonance, he should be the one to face Van. And once again, Ash gets pissed off at Luke. How does he know which one's better? How could he possibly know that Ash is better than him? He's never tried, he's never put it to the test. But that's about to change. Right here, right now, they'll put it to the test. Who really is the strongest? So, Luke is victorious, stronger of the two. Unfortunately, you don't really have time to come to terms with that, as a platoon of New Order soldiers show up. Ash hurriedly activates the pad and urges Luke to go and deal with Van. Luke is hesitant, but agrees and runs off to regroup with his friends, leaving Ash to guard his back.
Trouble. The rest is up to you.
He's gone. But the final god general still stands in your way. Sync. Like he said before, he's a replica. A useless puppet created to fill Ion's place. A task which he ultimately failed. The score had created his useless existence. And he wanted to destroy that. Ben gave him the opportunity to do so. So he too will fight until the bitter end in search of that ideal. Still, despite having the powers rivaling that of a phone master, he doesn't stand much of a chance against your party. You deal with him, bringing an end to the final God General. But this is it. There's nothing standing in your way. The only obstacle left between you and freeing Lorelei is Van. For one last time, both sides try to convince the other to join them, both believing that what they are doing is right, both believing the other would only lead to ruin. Unfortunately, neither side will ever be able to see eye to eye. This can only end one way. You begin your fight with Van. It's a fierce battle as both sides send powerful attacks, one after the other, crashing into them. The key of Lorelei should be able to free Lorelei, but it seems like Van is somehow keeping it suppressed within him. But what if Lorelei's power were to awaken? Awaken within Van. Then the sword would be able to activate and free Lorelei from within him. Fortunately, Tyr happens to have a power capable of doing just that. The Grand Faunic Hymn. The ancient song. A pact sung by Yulia between her and Lorelei. Well, the two of you need to work together to try whatever it takes to free Lorelei. Unfortunately, it seems like keeping a sentient ball of magic within you has some strange side effects, and Van has mutated, let's say. His grip on Lorelei is weakening, but unfortunately, his strength is only increasing in turn. Your group are forced to the very limit as blow after powerful blow rain down upon your party. But eventually, you break through. Tyr finally realizes something. The final piece of the Grand Faunic Hymn. She knew it all along. It was a lullaby, sung to her when she was a child by her brother. Finally, Van is, once and for all, truly defeated. However, Lorelei still needs to be fully freed from his body, and only Luke can do that. He tells everyone to leave while he performs the art necessary to release Lorelei. And so, everyone says their goodbyes to Luke. Deep down, they all knew that, after the incident of the tower, Luke was destined to disappear. But at the same time, it's something they just can't accept as reality. In their own ways, Jade, Guy, Annis, Natalia, even Mew, all make Luke promise that he will return. Until only Tyr remains.
Come home!
Tyr.
You have to come home! You have to! I'll be waiting. Always.
I will. I promise. I'll come home.
Luke, I love you.
So the world did not vanish. To think the future I saw would be rewritten. You have done admirably.
Never say.
come. I believe your presence was requested at Luke's coming-of-age ceremony at the Duke's Manor.
I'm not interested in some ceremony in front of Luke's grave.
That's why the both of you came here, isn't it?
He said he'd be back, so let the others sit around and tell stories at his grave. But I won't be joining them.
We should be heading back soon. The valley is dangerous at night.
Why are you here?
This place has a nice view of Hod. And also, I promised someone.